ظلمات الوهم وأدخلنا في نور العلم وجمل أخلاقنا بالحلم. اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى يا رب العالمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وعنده مفاتح الغيب لا يعلمها إلا هو ويعلم ما في البر والبحر وما تسقط من ورقة إلا يعلمها ولا حبة في ظلمات الأرض ولا رطب ولا يابس إلا في كتاب مبين. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. Continue inshaAllah subhanahu wa ta'ala our majalis of Tafsir al-Quran al-Kareem. And we started last week with an introduction to the science of Tafsir and some of the basics of this science and some of the keys to understand the science of the Tafsir, which is necessary for any student of knowledge. بدأنا في الأسبوع الماضي بفضل الله تعالى وحوله وقوته بعض المبادئ التي ينبغي لطالب العلم أن يتعلمها قبل أن يشرع في دراسة أي علم. قلنا أن هناك مبادئ عشرة لا بد لطالب العلم أن يتقنها وأن يعلمها قبل أن يبدأ في دراسة أي علم من العلوم، وقد نظمها الشيخ محمد بن الصبان في حاشيته على شرحية الفيت بن مالك وفي العقائد النسفية كذلك في حاشيته، حيث قال: اعلم أن مبادئ كل فن عشرة: الحد والموضوع ثم الثمرة وفضله ونسبة والواضع الاسم الاستمداد حكم الشارع ومسائل والبعض بالبعض اكتفى ومن درى الجميع حاز الشرف. فكانت هذه المبادئ العشر للعلم تحدثنا في الأسبوع الماضي منها عن أولها وهو الحد، وقلنا أن الحد هو التعريف الجامع المانع لاسم هذا العلم وبعض المصطلحات المستخدمة في هذا العلم. So the 10 basics that we talked about last week, we explained the first one of them, which is al-had, or the precise definition of the subject matter that we talk about. And we finished, alhamdulillah, the definition of the word tafsir. What does the word tafsir mean? And what does the word ta'wil mean? And we made a comparison between the tafsir and ta'wil, if my memory is good, correct? We finished that. We said what ما هو الفروق الخمسة أو بعض الأقوال للعلماء الأفاضل في التفريق ما بين التفسير والتأويل. كما أعتقد أننا قلنا أن عند المتقدمين التفسير والتأويل بمعنى واحد، مثل عند شيخ المفسرين الإمام الطبري هو قال التفسير تأويل والتأويل تفسير، ثم جاء المتأخرون وفصلوا بين وفرقوا بين التفسير والتأويل. We said that in the early scholars like شيخ المفسرين, the Sheikh of all exegetes, الإمام الطبري, he says that تفسير and تأويل are the same thing. But the more recent scholars, they differentiated between تفسير and تأويل. And we finished that last week. So today, inshallah, we continue with the rest of what we didn't cover last week. So we need to define now what is the definition of the word Quran. What is the definition of the word Quran? When we say Quran, what does it mean, Quran? Did we talk about it last week? Mm-hmm. No? طيب ما هو تعريف القرآن؟ إذا سألك إنسان لا سيما غير مسلم وقال لك ما هو القرآن؟ كيف تعرف لي القرآن؟ فماذا تجيب؟ What would you answer if someone asked you about the Quran? Any suggestions?
شيخ المفسر. هو كلام الله المنزل على النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم عن طريق الوحي المنقول إلينا بالتواتر المتعبد بتلاوته.
أحسن. جزاك الله خير. هذا هو تفسير القرآن وهو أو حد القرآن وهو حد جامع مانع وهو كلام الله. فإذا أردت أن تعرف تعريفا بالحد فيجب أن تبدأ بالجنس. هذا في علم المنطق، ولكن يعني لا نريد أن نترك الموضوع وندخل في علم التصورات والتصديقات في علم المنطق. فيعني يكفي أن نقول لا تبدأ بالجنس ثم الفصل ثم بعض الصفات. فهو كلام الله. The Quran is the words of Allah. I cannot stop here because the words of Allah include also the Injil and the Torah and the Zabur, wa suhuf Sheikh, wa suhuf Ibrahim, wa suhuf Musa, يعني وكل هذه أنواع الحديث القدسي كذلك. فلا أستطيع أن أقول هو كلام الله وأقف وكلام الله وأقف، لأن هذا لا يكون إذن تعريف مانعا وإن كان جامعا ولكن ليس مانعا، لأنه يدخل في التعريف أفراد ليست من المعرف. So we cannot just say it is the words of Allah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed approximately 114 books. صح أنزل الله سبحانه وتعالى 14 و100 كتابا وصح ما بين كتاب وصحيف مثل صحف شيث وصحف إبراهيم والتوراة والزبور والإنجيل. سبحان الله. See, Allah revealed 114 books like the chapters of the Quran. It's not like the Surah Al-Nas was revealed to someone and Surah Al-Ikhlas was لا. It is just the total number, coincidence, سبحان الله or not coincidence, was 114 books, like the numbers of, like the number of the surahs of the Quran. يغني القرآن القرآن عنها جميعا ولا تغني أيهما ولا هي مجتمع عن القرآن. So those 114 books that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed before the Quran suffices you, you don't need any of them. The Quran has got everything that these books had plus way more. Way more benefits and way more that exist in this. And this, so the Quran suffices you from this book, but all these books together, even they do not suffice you, they cannot replace the Quran, not even a fraction of the Quran. وكان سيدنا عمر رضي الله عنه أحيانا يستمع إلى يهود بني قريظة وما يتلى وما يتلو من القرآن ليعرف ماذا يقولون عن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu used to go and listen to the Jews who lived in a tribe called Bani Qurayza. To listen to know what they say about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just because they used to, when they say something in public, it's different when they say in the inner circles. So they go outside and say, oh, he's not a prophet, we don't believe in him, etc., etc. But inside, when they sit together and talk, they know that he's the prophet. He used to love to go and listen to them. And then one day he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he asked, can I tell you what I heard about the verses of the Torah that they say? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his face changed. وَكَانَ لِنُورَانِيَّةِ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِذَا غَضِبْ كَأَنَّكَ فَقَأْتَ فِي وَجْهِ حَبَّ الرُّمَّانِ. كان بنوره صلى الله عليه وسلم تعرف في وجهه إذا تغير وإذا غضب. Rasulullah, because of the nur in his face, when he changes, when he gets angry, you straight away can tell. As if, you know, pomegranate, you know, the small, what do you call, particles, these red things inside the pomegranate in the rumman, as if they are in the face of Rasulullah, because of his, you know, the whiteness and the nur in his face. So he changed. So Umar ibn Khattab straight away, he saw that Rasulullah has become angry, and he said, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَأَنَّكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. He did the shahada and he said, رَضِينَ بِاللَّهِ رَبَّنَ وَالْإِسْلَامِ دِينَ وَبِسَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. So إِلَى آخِرِ الْحَدِيثِ. So that's why whatever in the Quran suffices us, and we don't need anything else. فَجَاءَ الْقُرْآنُ مُهَيْمِنًا على كل ما أنزل الله سبحانه وتعالى قبله من الكتب والصحف. فالقرآن هو كإذن كلام الله المنزل على سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم بالوحي، لأن في طرق أخرى أوحى الله بها أو ألهم الله بها الله سبحانه وتعالى إلى نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم، كالنفث في الروع مثلا وكالإلهام، وكسنته صلى الله عليه وسلم، فكان التوفيق وإلهام من الله سبحانه وتعالى وليست بالضرورة من خلال جبريل عليه السلام. أما القرآن كله فجاء من خلال الوحي سيدنا جبريل، لذلك كما تفضل الشيخ صالح وقال المنزل على سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم بالوحي. طيب المتعبد بتلاوته, that it is a worship to, it is a worship to recite the Quran. It is an integral part of one of the pillars of Islam, which is the salah. The Quran is an integral part. إِذَا صَلَّيْتَ بِالْقُرْآنِ أَجْزَأَتْكَ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِذَا صَلَّيْتَ بِغَيْرِكَ بِالْحَدِيثِ الْقُدُسِيِّ مَثَلًا فَلَا تُجْزِئِ الصَّلَاةِ وَتَكُونُ بَاطِلَةً وَلَا فَتَبْطُلُ الصَّلَاةِ أَسَاسًا. والوحي إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أو ما أنزل الله إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ثلاثة أنواع. Three types of messages or revelations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. The first one is the Quran. أولها القرآن وهو ما أنزل إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالمعنى واللفظ. معنى توقيفي واللفظ اللفظ توقيفي. What is revealed to Rasulullah ﷺ, both by the meaning and by the word, which is the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran to Rasulullah ﷺ with the meanings. Rasulullah ﷺ understood the meanings, and also the wording of this meaning, the verses, word by word, letter by letter, dot by dot, is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The sequence of the ayat, the tartib of the ayat, the sequence of surah, of surahs, وترتيب الصور كل توقيفي وأسماء الصور كلها توقيفية من عند الله سبحانه وتعالى ليست من توفيق من توفيق أحد. فهل ترتيب الصور مثلا توقيفي أم توفيقي؟ لا, كلها توقيفي. It is all the sequence order of the surahs, the order that is توقيف from Allah, means it is from Allah سبحانه وتعالى without any اجتهاد from anyone, even Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the tertib of the ayah. This is the first type of revelation to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. The second type of revelation, which is بالتوفيق وبالإلهام من الله سبحانه وتعالى. لا بالمعنى ولا باللفظ. ولكن إلهام وتوفيق من الله سبحانه وتعالى للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهي سنته صلى الله عليه وسلم. الحديث الشريف. The other type is a guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he straight put on the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is his sunnah. It is not by word and not by even the meaning. And no one came, no wahi came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and told him, look, this is the meaning and then you word it in the way you want. La, this is direct guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is sunnah al-mutahhar. And in between, there is al-ahadith al-Qudusi. There are the Qudusi ahadith, وهي على الراجح أنها توحي من الله سبحانه وتعالى رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم بالمعنى واللفظ من عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Which is ahadith al-Qudusi, is a revelation by the wahy to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم through Jibreel, but only by the معنى, only by the meaning. And the choice of the wording is from Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. So this is the difference between al-Hadith al-Qudusi and al-Qur'an al-Kareem. The difference between al-Hadith al-Qudusi is both a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The meaning of both is both from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the wording of the Qur'an is also from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the wording of Hadith al-Qudusi is from the tawfiq and ijtihad of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فإذا تعريف القرآن كلام الله المنزل على سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم المتعبد بتلاوته المعجز ولو بأصغر صورة منه. وممكن أن تضيف المكتوب في المصاحف المبدوء بسورة الفاتحة والمختتم بسورة الناس. You can add all these extra clarifications to the definition, which is that is written in the Mus'haf, that is miraculous. That starts with Al-Fatiha and ends with Surah Al-Nas. في شيء تاني شيخ صالح؟ إلى جانب هذه؟ المنقول إلينا بالتواتر. That's another condition that the Quran has been transmitted to us through the tawatur. What is tawatur?
Continuity.
Not only continuity. It is continuity.
With intervals. With intervals. With intervals.
With what do you mean intervals?
Not in one go, just after some time.
No, no. It is continuity, and ما قاله الشيخ صالح ما نقل.
جمع عن جمع.
نعم. ما رواه جمع عن جمع يستحيل في قيد كمان يستحيل تواطؤهم على الكذب أو الخطأ. حتى يكون التعريف قد دقيق. التواتر هو ما نقل أو أنا بالفينيش عندنا إن شاء الله والبريك فور صلاة العشاء ما نقل إلينا بالتواتر حيث ما رواه ما هو التواتر ما رواه ما جاء إلينا ما رواه جمع عن جمع يستحيل تواطؤهم على الخطأ أو الكذب. That a huge number of people transmitted to a huge number of people and so on. So it is not one. The chain of transmission is not one one one. Even if every single person in the chain is golden link, is a trustworthy link, not only this, tawatur is much more than this, that in every link, in every layer, there is a large number of people, a large number of people, a large number of people. And not only this as well. So it's not only a continuous link, like every layer has got multiple people, but not only that. There is an even more strict condition. That those people who are a huge number of people by no way can come together to make a mistake or to agree to lie or to make to lie together by agreement. They can't. Because if all of you, how many of you, mashallah, have like 70 people here? Right? If you all go and say the same thing, that is not tawatur. Because you heard it from single source. And all of you, I can make one mistake. And all of you hear from me the same mistake, and you go and transmit that mistake. فهذا الجمع لا يعتد في التواتر. وإن كان 70، ما شاء الله عددكم 70، ولكن ليعتد في النوم لأنه ممكن أن تخطأوا جميعا. لماذا؟ لأنني أخطأت، قلت شيئا خطأ، وأنتم سمعتموه مني وصدقتموني لحسن ظنكم بي، جزاكم الله خير. فقلت فذهبتم جميعا ونقلتم نفس الخطأ. فشوف برغم هذا العدد ولكن لا يعتد به في التواتر. ولكن كمان شرط لا يمكن تواطؤهم على الخطأ، أي سمعوهم من مصادر متفرقة بطرق متفرقة، لا يمكن أن كلهم من جميع يقعوا في نفس الخطأ. ولا يمكن أن يتفقوا على الكذب. So the number is, so you, although you mashallah you're a large number, but you can make the same mistake because you heard it from one single source. But if you hear, if this jama' heard from me something, heard from Sheikh Omar something, and Sheikh Abdul Ma'iz something, and Sheikh so-and-so something, exactly the same thing. And I've never seen this Sheikh in my life. But we come and say the same thing. Is there a possibility that we together agreed to make a mistake, or both of us make an unintentional mistake? In no way. So that's why that in every layer that the Quran came us through different, large number of people, and in every layer, those large number of people, they cannot agree to make the same error or actually make the same mistake unintentionally. So see, these are the three conditions in at-tawatur. And by this, we finish the definition of the Qur'an. And then after Salat al-Asha, inshallah, we continue with the rest of the introduction to this science of tafsir. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعليه وصحبه وسلم. بعد أن انتهينا من هذه المقدمة القصيرة نتابع الكلام في بقية المبادئ العشرة، وثاني هذه المبادئ هي الموضوع، موضوع القرآن الكريم. ما هو موضوع علم التفسير. So the second thing is, what is the subject that this science focuses on, the science of تفسير. Of course, as you know, الموضوع هو القرآن الكريم من حيث قراءاته والنطق بمفرداته وآياته ومدلولات أحكامه الإفرادية والتركيبية، وعن معانيه التي تحمل عليها حال التركيب أو ترجيحات ذلك. طيب، هذا هو موضوع علم التفسير، وسوف إن شاء الله أحاول التفصيل في هذه ما ذكرنا كلمة كلمة إن شاء الله. So the subject of this science is the words of the Quran al-Kareem from the perspective on its qira'at, its recitations, its the meanings of its words and the meaning of its sentences. So the meaning of the word, word by word, but not only word by word, but the meaning of the sentence as a whole. plus extracting the wisdoms and the rulings, juristic rulings from the Quran. So this is the topics of the science of tafsir. طيب, do you notice that أن موضوع التفسير تشتمل على القراءات وعلى النطق به مع إن هذا هو علم التجويد. We notice that part of what I said is that this science include the recitations of the Quran and how to pronounce it. But we know that this, the recitation of the Quran, the pronunciation of the Quran, is actually another science that is called tajweed, right? ولكن كان هذا هذا هو حال العلوم الشرعية يصنف في علم حيث يحتوي على مسائل كثيرة ثم يزيد هذا العلم وينبغ فيه علماء ثم يكبر ويكبر حتى يستقل تستقل بعد مواضيع العلم كعلم مستقل وتصبح علوما مستقلة. So this is, you find that this is the nature of these sciences. It starts as just a subject, a science, and then it grows and grows and grows, and then until part of it becomes, separates and becomes a science on its own because of its size. Just like before, for example, يعني الله المثل الأعلى كان هناك علم الحساب أو علم الرياضيات علم واحد كبر وكبر وكبر حتى أصبح وتفرق إلى علوم الهندسة والجبر والتفاضل والتكامل وفيزياء وهكذا. Mathematics, for example, it was a science called mathematics, just one science. But then started to grow and grow until parts of it or some topics has separated and they became a science. It's like coordinate geometry, algebra, calculus, and so on and so forth. Calculus has become a separate science because it's grow a lot. Geometry, trigonometry. Right? If all of these sciences have separated, became separate sciences due to its size. Likewise, and also due to the capacity of the students. Before, you have one student who is able to know all the recitations of the Quran. Just easy for him, plus all the tafsir, plus the fiqh, plus everything. But nowadays, the capacity of the students, it's very hard to find someone who can know the whole recitations of the Quran plus the tafsir and become specialized in many sciences. So every one of us is actually specializing in one science or another, and that's even too much for him or her. Right? But in early days, yes, the recitation of the Quran and the pronunciation of the Quran was part of the tafsir. ثم استقل هذا العلم على يد أعتقد الإمام أبو عمرو الداني حيث أول من صنف ومنذ عصر الإمام أبو عمرو الداني أصبح علم التجويد علم مستقل. طيب, so the science of تجويد has separated since the time of the scientist called أبو عمرو الداني. From his time, science of تجويد has become a separate science on its own. Likewise, the sciences of the Quran, the sciences of the Quran, النسخ والمنسوخ, المدني والمكي, أسباب النزول, all this has became, this is a separate science called the sciences of the Quran, separate from the tafsir. But originally, the tafsir, that was all included under the tafsir. فإذا القرآن الكريم من حيث بيانيت كيف النطق, كيفية النطق به وبيان مدلولاته. ما هو المدلول؟ المدلول أي المعنى المعجمي للكلمة, الدلالة اللفظية. So the meanings is like the linguistic, the meanings of the words as you get it from the dictionary. As you get it from the dictionary, right? So the meaning of this word in the dictionary is so and so. طيب؟ وهذا هو المعنى الإفرادي للكلمة. هذا هو ما مسمى بالأحكام الإفرادية. أي the meaning of one word. Only one word. But when you put words together and you get a sentence, the meaning of the whole is different from the meaning of the parts. The meaning of the whole will give you totally different meaning than the meaning of the word separately. مثال كما قلنا أعتقد في الدرس السابق من كان في هذه أعمى فهو في الآخرة أعمى وأضل سبيل. When Allah SWT says in Surah Al-Isra, whoever is blind in this dunya, He is blind in the hereafter. So if you take the word a'ma, what was the word a'ma means? Blind. Fi hadith dunya, in this world, then he is blind, a'ma, again, in the fil akhirah, in the hereafter. So these are the literal meaning of word by word. But when you look at the sentence, does it really mean that the person who is blind in this dunya will be blind in the hereafter? Definitely not. So what does it mean? إذن المعنى التركيبي هو معنى تؤول إليه الآية أو تحمل عليه الآية هو معنى ثاني تحمل إليه الآية ليس المعنى الأول الذي يتبادر إلى الذهن. وهذا هو ما يسمى في علم البلاغة علم المجاز. في المجاز والكناية. المجاز والكناية. I think I gave also an example last week عندما when a woman came to أمير المؤمنين and she told him the mice in my house are walking on sticks. يعني they see the word by word it has got a meaning. But what is the intention of that woman? What actually she meant? عندما يقول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لأحد الناس إنك عريض الوسادة في الحديث when the Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم tells someone your pillow is so wide or you are a person that you sleep till duha and رجل إيه تقوم في الضحى. هل المعنى أنك يريد فعلا يقول لك أنك شخص تقوم في الضحى؟ ماذا نستفيد إذا كنت تقوم في الضحى أو عريض الوسادة؟ لا المعنى آخر في هناك معنى آخر مراد. When I say that you are a person who wakes up at noon time. If I say if someone is very eloquent, come and tell you, Tariq Akar, he wakes up at noon time. What do you benefit if he wakes up at noon time or 10 a.m. or 5? What do you benefit? What do you care? لا, so there is a meaning behind it. Which he is, he is a person who is so rich, mashallah, has got a lot of servants, a lot of people who do all, he doesn't need to wake up early like us to go and work and earn money, khalas. صح? When you tell someone that you are عريض الوسادة, your pillow is so big, what does it mean? That he's slack, he's lazy, he sleeps a lot, he loves his pillow because his pillow is... So it's not that I really want to inform you that his pillow is wide, لا, there is another meaning behind what I'm saying. Perhaps Ahmed can tell us, Ahmed Raji can tell us equivalent Uzi. It's like like a doornail, you are like a doornail, you're flatter. I'm busy as a doornail. Tell you like a doornail.
Sheikh is saying, if you snooze, you lose.
If you snooze, you lose. لا, هذا ساجح. هذا في علم الساجح. لا, something is like a door.
Dead
as a doornail. هذه كناية. It means something. And so on. طب هذا هو موضوع علم القرآن. What is the fruit of studying the tafsir? وهي ثمرة دراسة علم التفسير. طيب القرآن هو منهج حياة ليس فقط كتاب معجز في البلاغة وفي البيان ومليء بالأحكام الفقهية التي نحتاجها يعني للتحكيم وللقضاء إلى آخره ولكنه كتاب منهج هو منهج كامل للحياة. ومن اتخذ الغراب صاحبا مر بها على دليلا واتخذ الغراب دليلا مر بها على كل جثث الكلاب. This is similar to what you just said. طيب, what is the fruit of quickly? What is the fruit of studying tafsir? The Quran is a complete methodology of life, a complete way of life, an absolute happiness and shifa in this world. The more that you learn the Quran, the more you can apply it in your day-to-day life matters. It's a full solution for everything. Another thing is, it is the main source of al-fiqh al-akbar wal-fiqh al-azhar. Usul al-deen wa furu' al-deen. It is the main source of the usul al-deen, which is the aqidah, and also the fiqh ruling and juristic ruling, which we need. And you see people here, without the Quran, without the revelation, when someone dies, they fight with each other, how they distribute the wealth, inheritance, all this is already solved in the most perfect way in our deen. And it is a separate science called يسمى علم الفرائض هو علم مستقل كامل يدرس لغائه درسناه كعلم يعني طوال سنة كاملة علم مستقل يسمى علم الفرائض أو علم المواريث. We studied a full subject for over a full year, a science called the science of mirath. All came from the Quran and from the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Another thing is tarbiyat al-akhlaq. The Quran is full of tarbiyah for the manners, for the spiritual discipline of each of the nafs. The Quran is a main source of this. As well as, says the Quran says, وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَاهَا فَأَلْهَمْهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. شوف التذكير والتركيز على التربية النفسية. نون والقلم وما يسطرون وما أنت بنعمة ربك مجنون وإنك لعلى خلق عظيم. So the akhlaq and the akhlaq in the Quran is the main integral of the Quran, the tarbiyah of the akhlaq. طيب فضله, what is the merits of the Quran? هو من أشرف العلوم على الإطلاق. You remember in the course of hadith when we classified sciences into four different types, عندما تكلمنا عن الدوائر الأربعة للعلوم, أي علم على وجه هذه الأرض يدخل تحت واحدة من أربع دوائر. باختصار سريع جدا, العلوم الشرعية وهي أشرف العلوم على الإطلاق, دائرة العلوم الشرعية, ثم بعدها دائرة العلوم الطبيعية, ثم بعدها دائرة العلوم الطبيعية عن الفيزياء والكيمياء والكهرومغناطيسية وهذه الأشياء, ثم دائرة العلوم الرياضية وهو الحساب والرياضة والهندسة والجبر والتفاضل والتكامل والإحصاء, ثم آخر العلوم هي أقلها مرتبة وهي العلوم الإنسانية, علم النفس وعلم الاجتماع وعلم. ولماذا هي أخص العلوم أو هي أقل العلوم؟ لأنها أقل العلوم انضباطا. في هذه العلوم ليس هناك نظرية. في الرياضة مصر 1+1=2, أما في العلوم الإنسانية علم الاجتماع وعلم النفس هذه نظريات يعني تتدخل في, ليست موضوعية وإنما ذاتية, تتدخل فيها شخصية الباحث وشخصية المنظر وليس ولا تضبط, صعب جدا أن تضبط, لذلك أقل العلوم في الشرف. So the four circles of sciences are the sciences of the Sharia sciences, which are the most noble sciences ever, sciences of Hadith and the Quran, because they came from the divine being, they came from the Creator. They do not contradict with logic, never contradict with logic, but they surpass logic. They are above and more advanced than even our logic and intellectual capability can comprehend. We can comprehend some, but not even, yeah, we don't even scratch the surface. That's why it is the most noble sciences ever. Then the second tier of sciences are the sciences of the physical sciences, which is biology, chemistry, physics, electromagnetism, etc., etc. And then the third tier of sciences is the mathematics, the sciences of mathematics, coordinate geometry, algebra, calculus, statistics, etc., etc. Right? And then the worst or the least, the last tier of sciences is the social sciences. Social science, which is the science of the sociology and psychology. And why is this the least? Because there is no, you know, in mathematics, 1+1=2, that's it, right? But in the social sciences, there is no such clear-cut rules or theories. It is all, it's very hard to control, very hard, and it is very, very subjective, not objective. Depends on the scientist himself, and it's very hard to control. That's why it is the least sciences. So the Quran, where the Quran falls in these circles, in these tiers? Of course, the Quran falls into the most noble tier, which is the rules of Sharia, and it is the noble of the noble. وليس فقط هي من أشرف العلوم العلوم الشرعية بل هو من أشرف العلوم الشرعية كما على الإطلاق لأن شرف العلم يتعلق بشرف موضوعه. هذه قاعدة. شرف العلم يتعلق بشرف الموضوع. فإن كان موضوع القرآن وكلام الله عز وجل هو أشرف شيء، إذن فعلم التفسير هو كعلم التجويد، وعلوم القرآن إذن هي من أشرف العلوم على الإطلاق. So the Quran is the most noble because it the honor of a science, or the science takes its honor from the honor of the subject, and the subject is the words of Allah. That's why tafsir is the most noble subject. Next slide. Who is the first author in الواضع؟ الواضع بقى من هو أول من صنف في التفسير؟ قال أول من صنف في التفسير هو الإمام أنس مالك بن أنس الأصبحي رضي الله عنه وأرضاه في الموطأ، حيث أفرد جزءا من موطئه في الأحاديث التي الخاصة بالتفسير، بعض الآيات التي فسرها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the first author in تفسير was Imam Malik in his hadith book, where he narrated a number of hadith that are related to tafsir. But يعني it is not a tafsir book as such. ولكن يعتبر شيخ المفسرين على إطلاق الإمام الطبري. And we'll talk about later, inshallah. So there's no point to talk about it now. Inshallah, we'll talk about it more in details about the Imam Tabari and his tafsir, tafsir al-Tabari. What are the names of this science? التفسير والتأويل. خلاص, we finish this. الاستمداد, من أين يستمد هذا العلم؟ من يستمد هذا العلم مصادره؟ أو مصادر هذا العلم هو السنة, تفسير النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, وما ورد عن الصحابة من تفسير. ثم علوم اللغة, النحو والصرف والبلاغة وعلم اللغة وفقه اللغة وأصول الفقه وعلم الكلام. هذه هي مصادر التفسير. So where are the source of information that this science takes information from? Is of course the Sunnah, the Hadith that talks about tafsir, the sayings of some of the Sahaba, the sciences of Arabic languages, there are about 10 sciences of Arabic language by itself, and the usul of fiqh, or the methodology of fiqh. وما هو حكم الشارع في تعلم هذا العلم؟ Last point is, what is the ruling on learning this science? كما قلنا أن الأحكام الشرعية كام؟ خمس: الفرض والمندوب والمباح والمكروه والحرام. We said that the five, what are the five rulings of Sharia? Anything that you do in your life falls under one of five categories. Either it is a fard or a sunnah or a permissible. Just permissible, you don't get a thawab or a iqab or a punishment if you don't do it, or if you do it. And then the makruh and the haram. Those are the five categories of ahkam. So where is, if now I'm studying tafsir, where it falls? In which category? It is in the fard. Right? Type. Under the fard, under some of these categories, there are subtypes. Like the fard, there is different types of fard. There's fard ayn, fard kifaya, fard muaqqat, fard ghir muaqqat, fard muqaddar, fard ghir muqaddar. كل هذا ندرسه في علم أصول الفقه. فرد مؤقت أي مرتبط بوقت زي شهر رمضان. ولكن في فرد غير مؤقت زي بر الوالدين, هل له وقت؟ ليس له وقت. فرد مقدر زي الزكاة 2.5% له قدر معين. ولكن فرد غير مقدر زي بر الوالدين برضه, هل في قدر معين لبر الوالدين؟ ولا تقعد تبر على قدر, يعني تبر بقدر ما تستطيع. وفي فرض عين أي فرض على كل مسلم ومسلمة, وفي فرض كفاية أي إذا قام به بعض الناس بعدد يكفي سقط الفرض عن بقية الناس وأصبح مستحبا في حقهم. طيب, under the fard we have the personal fard, personal obligation, we have the communal obligation, we have the timed obligation and untimed obligation, and we have quantified fard and unquantified fard. All these are subtypes of fard. All of them are fard. There are different types. So what is a quantified fard? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made something obligatory and he specified a particular quantity, like the zakah, for example. 2.5% of your wealth, that's a quantified. Shahr Ramadan, it is 1 month. You cannot fast Ramadan 40 days, right? It is definite quantity. But and is unquantified fard, like birrul walidain, being kind to your parents. There is no particular quantity that you fulfill, or there is no particular time, again, with birrul walidain. There is a personal fard that is every single person must perform, like the salah, salatul dhuhr, salatul asha. Is it a fard on every single Muslim male and female, right? However, and there is a communal fard where a number of people, if they do it, if they undertake this fard, and this number is sufficient, then the rest of the people do not have to undertake this task. For example, types. So tafsir is a fard kifay, is a communal fard. Like there must be enough number of people in the community who specializes and become scholars of and master this science. If we don't have enough of them, suppose we have 10 in Sydney, and 10 is not enough, then all of us are in sin until we fill in the gap. Huffaz of the Quran, people who can know the tajweed, know the fiqh of salah. If we have 10 or 50 of them, but we have 200 masjids in jama'ah, all of us, some of us must go ahead and fold up their sleeves and should go and dedicate themselves to study to fill the gap, to bridge that gap. And once there is enough number, خلاص. لذلك يسمى كفاية أي عدد كافي. يجب أن يقوم به عدد كافي من الناس بحيث يسقط على بقية الناس. طيب. So it is فرض كفاية in general plus also personal فرض for every single one of us to know part of the tafsir according to his or her capacity. Like suppose we have 200 people scholars of tafsir, and they are enough. In every masjid we have a scholar in tafsir. So you don't need to study tafsir? No. It is also hard for you to start to do your best. You don't need to be the scholar of the scholars, yani, or a mujtahid or a mufassir, but you need to learn and understand as much as you can. Because if you don't, yani, see, when we talked about the benefits and the fruits of studying tafsir, you miss out on all these things. How come you want to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you will meet him one day and you don't know anything in his Quran? I don't know what this ayah means or what this ayah means. I don't know. Can you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like this? أَلْتَصَانْ تُقَابِلَ رَبَّكَ وَأَنْتَ لَا تَعْلَمْ وَلَا تَعْرِفْ مَعْنَى وَلَا آيَةَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ. مستحيل. يعني عليك أن تعلم بقدر تستطيع. لو كل يوم تعلمت آية واحدة, if every day you learn the meaning of one ayah, just one ayah, you'll finish Surah Al-Baqarah in 1 year. If you take the weekends off, even if you don't learn, you will not finish Surah Al-Baqarah. Another year, you'll finish Surah Al-Imran. Another year, you finish Surah Al-Nisa. And if you finish Al-Baqarah Al-Imran, أصبحت شيخا. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الحافظ البقرة Al-Imran فشيخه. أو روي عنه صلى الله عليه وسلم, ليس قال يعني, السند فيه كلام. If you know the tafsir of Surah Al-Baqarah وآل عمران النساء, you become a scholar. والله, you know, you become one of the top scholars in Australia. You just sit in my place and just give the tafsir of this surah. If you just know the tafsir of this three surahs by itself. Alright? So this is a quick introduction about, next slide. This is a quick introduction about the tafsir. Inshallah, we'll finish in 20 minutes, and then we'll have questions and answers. So the second part, which I'll finish today, inshallah, only 3 slides. Manahij wa anwa' tafsir, methodologies and types of tafsir. As I said, that tafsir is not just one, not all books of tafsir the same. ليس كل المفسرون سواء. All these books, we have hundreds and hundreds of books of tafsir. Not all of them are the same. Not just you can pick up anyone and choose. Like, they are different. There are different methodologies of tafsir, different perspectives of tafsir, different specialities of tafsir. Exactly like when we talked about the hadith, you remember? We said that there is a book of hadith called Sunnah. There is a book of hadith called Jama'. What's the difference between Jama' al-Bukhari and Sunan al-Tirmidhi? كلنا كتاب السنن يتعلق أو مرتب ترتيب على أبواب الفقه ويتعلق بمواضيع الفقه فقط فيبدأ بالطهارة والصلاة والصيام والزكاة إلى آخره. أما الجامع كجامع البخاري فهو كتاب يتضمن ثمانية أبواب الشريعة أو الدين كله: تاريخ وسير ومناقب ومثالب وأخلاق وتفسير وأحكام وفقه وعقائد. كل هذه أنواع تدخل في الجامع في كتاب جامع الحديث. طيب, what are the methodologies of tafsir? There are two main methodologies of tafsir. هناك نوعين رئيسيين أو منهجين رئيسيين للتفسير, هو التفسير بالمأثور والتفسير بالرأي. التفسير بالمأثور والتفسير بالاجتهاد. A narration based tafsir and an اجتهاد based tafsir. ما هو التفسير المأثور وما هو التفسير بالرأي؟ التفسير بالمأثور هو ما جاء تفسير القرآن بالقرآن أو تفسير القرآن بالسنة, وهذا متفق عليه, أو تفسير والصحابة كذلك وتفسير ما فسره الصحابة, وهذا متفق عليه, واختلف في تفسير التابعين هل هو يدخل ضمن التفسير بالمأثور أم بالاجتهاد, والغالب أنه يدخل ضمن التفسير بالمأثور. Right? So the narration-based tafsir is a tafsir that is purely based on narrations, hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or tafsir of the Qur'an by the Qur'an. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will talk about something in the ayah, and in another ayah, could be a totally different surah, Allah explains what is in this ayah. Like, فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. Adam has received words from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for tawbah. So Allah did give him tawbah. What are these words? Does this ayah tell? No, it doesn't. But you find it in another ayah, qala, رَبَّنَا إِنَّا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَهُ إِلَّا تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. So in total another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that both Adam and Eve, they said, رَبَّنَا إِنَّا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَهُ, oh Allah, we transgressed against ourselves, and if you did not forgive us, we'll be among the losers. So we knew then what are the words, what words that was revealed to Adam and Eve to do tawbah. And then we can then use these words for tawbah. We say, رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا ضَلَى, after every salah, isn't it a dua after every salah? In the dua al-ma'thur khalf al-salawat, رَبَّنَا إِنَّا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. فهذا من قبيل تفسير القرآن بالقرآن. So this is from the تفسير of the Quran by the Quran itself as well. طيب, and there is a تفسير of the Quran by the hadith of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the hadith that came by Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم explaining or doing تفسير of some of the ayah. ولم يفسر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم القرآن كاملا. Rasulullah did not give a full tafsir. He did not sit and ayah by ayah, ayah by ayah, give the tafsir of the Quran. Why is this? No, that is a يعني. The main reason that سبب الرئيس that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم did not give تفسير لأن القرآن يفسر إلى آخر الزمن إلى يوم القيامة ولا تنقضي عجائبه ولا تنقضي أسراره أبدا. The secrets in the Quran or the miracles of the Quran are not bound to one time or a particular age. It is an overflowing river of knowledge and wisdom and ahkam and scientific miracles, etc., etc., until the day of judgment. If Rasulullah would have did tafsir of the whole Quran, لا جمد لو كان فسر لو فسر صلى الله عليه وسلم لا جمد التفسير على ما قاله رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم في هذا الوقت وفقط وكان لا وأغلق باب الاستنباط من القرآن. Then no further ijtihad or extraction from the Quran. Khalas, what if Rasulullah would have explained the whole Quran or did tafsir of the whole Quran, then that would be it and that's it. Khalas, I would freeze at what Rasulullah said. And khalas, no more extraction of benefits and wisdoms and scientific miracles, etc., etc., till the day of judgment. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew, Allah taught him a lot of things. Right? And then he left Rasulullah because he understand the value of this. He left it by time and scholars to come to find and get more and more according to times and time. Like you see, all the scientific miracles of the Quran. Earth is like a big egg. The evolution of the baby in his mother uterus in the gestation period, of the 9 month gestation period, etc., etc. All these scientific miracles, when you knew about it in the last 50, 60 years. And many of the scientific miracles of the Quran were only known in the last 50, 60 years. And that's it. Right? So that's why Rasulullah did not give, the main reason that he did not give a full explanation of the Quran, so that the Quran will continue to, we continue to discover all these wisdoms from the Quran as we go. بما أننا فتحنا هذا الموضوع هل يجوز إذا اكتشفت نظرية علمية ووجدت إشارة لها في القرآن أن تكون هذا هو مراد الله سبحانه وتعالى من الآية. If we found that a theory, a scientific theory in the Quran, can we say, and we find that there is an ayah that talks about this scientific discovery, can you say that this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to, from this ayah? Can you say that? You can't. لأن النظرية هي مجرد نظرية. Theory is just a theory. It is a theory. Doesn't have a crystal clear or clear-cut evidence that this theory is correct. It may change in the future. This theory may be proven wrong in the future. What if you say that this is what Allah wanted from the ayah? What happens when you discover otherwise, or when science proven that it is wrong and it always happened? They tell us about the genetically modified food and how using the GMO or this stuff you can increase the the production of an acre of land by this and that. And then now they sell us all the genetically modified food will actually bring cancer and do this and you have to go and buy organic food. Right. So theories, the scientific theories change, they always go wrong. Right. People who worship science and they become atheists and worship science, they always go wrong. And they destroy humanity more than they benefited using their own science and research. But Quran is not. Right? But what if the theory actually has you found that a crystal clear evidence that this theory is right? Can you say that this is the what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant? Not precisely. You can say this is an indication of from the ayah. هذا هو قد بعض إشارة هذا ما تشير إليه الآية أو بعض ما تشير إليه الآية ولا تقول هذا هو مراد الله من هذه الآية لأن هذه الآية في المستقبل ممكن يتضح معنى ومعاني أكثر وأكثر في المستقبل فلا تقطع أن هذا هو مراد الله سبحانه وتعالى. So this is just a quick hint on the side. طيب so the narration based tafsir is the narration of the tafsir of the Quran by the Quran, the saying of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you have a lot of hadith. If you go to Sahih al-Bukhari, especially Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, and you will find a full parts of the Sahih according to all the hadith that came on the tafsir of that of these verses. Not all verses, as I said, some of the and intentionally Rasulullah ﷺ did not give the tafsir of the entire Quran. And also the saying of the Sahaba, saying of the successors or the followers of the Sahaba. Some people say it is part of the narration by tafsir type, and some people say no, it is not part of it. Long story short, we can assume that the saying of the followers of the Sahaba or the successors are also part of a tafsir bil ma'thul or the narration based tafsir. But what are the most famous books of tafsir bil ma'thul? There are lots of books talks about tafsir bil ma'thul, ولكن أشهرها هو جامع البيان عن تأويل آيات القرآن وهو تفسير شيخ المفسرين الإمام الطبري المتوفى سنة 1300. One of the most famous is جامع البيان in the تفسير or the تأويل of the Quran by Imam al-Tabari who died year 310 Hijri. And he is known as شيخ المفسرين. طيب هو كتاب عظيم يعني huge book جمع فيه الإمام الطبري كل ما أثر عن تفسير آيات القرآن بالإسناد بالإسناد وقيل من أسرد من سرد إليك الإسناد فقد أحالك هذه قاعدة مهمة إذا ذكر لك إمام إسناد فقد أحالك إذا ما أحالك لماذا؟ حالك أن تذهب وتبحث في صحة هذا الإسناد ليس عليه أن يقول لك هذا الحديث ضعيف أو صحيح أو قوي أو الجرح والتعديل والكلام عن الرجال في الإسناد لا ذكر لك الإسناد قد ألقى المسؤولية عليك وأصبح عليك أن تبحث So Imam Tabari he mentioned all the ahadith and the sayings that came in tafsir and he mentioned the full chain of transmission And this is a very big responsibility. When an imam gives you the full chain of transmission, they say he put the responsibility on your shoulders. You have to go then and research. So this sanad, is it sahih or da'if or mawdu' or what? That's why you cannot just take it, tafsir Imam al-Tabari and read in it. You'll say, عن جعفر, عن عبد الله بن الزبير, for example, في بعض التفاسير, من هو جعفر؟ متكلم فيه. الذي روى عن عبد الله بن الزبير. A man called he said that جعفر narrated by عبد الله بن الزبير رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said. When you saw this isnad chain of transmission, can you tell that if this hadith is a fabricated hadith or an authentic hadith? Can you tell? This was very dangerous to go and read from Tafsir Imam al-Tabari. Because they say if the imam or a book give you the chain of transmission, he puts the responsibility on you. You have to go and research. Right? Unlike the books where it doesn't mention and he tells you straight away what is the sahih and that's it. Right? So this is the first book of Al-Tafsir al-Ma'thur. كذلك معالم التنزيل للإمام البغوي الشافعي توفى سنة 1600. The second one is the Tafsir of Imam al-Baghawi. معالم التنزيل he died, he's الشافعي Imam. And he died in year 516. Then the book of لباب التأويل في معالم التنزيل الإمام الخازن الشافعي توفى سنة 41 و700 تفسير الخازن also by إمام الخازن who died in year 741 and he's also شافعي تفسير القرآن العظيم for ابن كثير توفى سنة 74 و700 تفسير القرآن العظيم for إمام ابن كثير who died in year 774 as well. الجواهر الحسان في تفسير القرآن للإمام الثعلبي المالكي المتوفى سنة 76 و800 تفسير المسمى تفسير الثعلبي. So those are some of the very famous تفسير books by narration based تفسير from إمام الطبري إمام البغوي إمام الخازن إمام ابن كثير إمام الثعلبي and they are all either مالكيز or شافعيز. I didn't find the book for Hanafis. things to take care of in using this type of tafsir, narration-based tafsir. Number one is the Israelite stuff, the children of Israel narrations. Especially when there is a hadith, Some successors and followers of the Sahaba or some people will go and sit with the Jews and with the Christians and they will take their own stories. And when they learn more about the stories and they read the Quran, they think that this story is relevant to this ayah. So tafsir of this ayah, this story that happened by this scholar of Bani Israel, etc. etc. You find it a lot. So this is something very dangerous. You have to take care of. You know, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam قال حتى إلا تكذبوهم ولا تصدقون. Also some do not call them liars and do not believe them. Because we know that their stories are, their books have been tweaked and modified and changed a lot. So there is no such thing that's called Torah at the moment. There's no such thing called Injil. It's all been changed and played with, tampered with. Right? So all their stories are unreliable. Right? And this is when Imam al-Tabari, for example, will give you the full isnad, and this is the story. Unless you are a scholar of hadith, of chains of transmission, you have to be very careful. You do not touch this book. You can touch it and you read it, but you don't take anything from it. Do not believe anything unless you go and check who is the man, what is the status of this chain of transmission. Is it authentic? Is it fabricated? Is it Israeliti? And there are lots of people who are known that have been telling a lot of the people with the book stories. So that's why to be very careful with Tafsir al-Tabari, Tafsir ibn Kathir, or in narration-based tafsirs in general. Type. Number two is Hathf al-Isnad. Even some people in some tafsir, he will bring the story and he will not mention the Isnad. So you can't even tell if this story is authentic or not. لأنه قد لا يلتزم المفسر بإرادة الإسناد في كل ما يروي من أحاديث أو روايات. تمام؟ فحذف الإسناد. ثانياً الوضع. Many people will even fabricate some stories and put it in the books of narration-based tafsir. So these are three things to be careful on when you deal with books of these types of books or these books of tafsir. And generally, these are for the scholars who know the isnad, who are aware, very much educated in the science of isnad. Tafsir ibn Kathir, Tafsir al-Khazin, Tafsir al-Tabari, etc. Okay? Next slide. The second type of the tafsir is the tafsir bil-ra'y, or the qualified opinion tafsir. Tafsir based on the qualified opinion of the scholars. Right? So it is now the scholar, the exegete, will go and read the Quran, he himself extract this ayah means so and so and so and so, and this means so and so and so, based on, and what did I say? Qualified opinion. There's a qualified imam, a qualified exegete, not any person. It's not by his opinion, it's not by his opinion. يعني ما قال كان سيدنا أبو بكر يقول أي سماء تظلني وأي أرض تقلني قلت في القرآن برأيي. القرآني برأي. إمام أبو بكر سيدنا أبو بكر رضي الله عنه used to say which earth will carry me and which sky I will be under if I would say the Quran with my opinion, if I talk about the Quran from my opinion. I can't. Right? So what does it mean here? It is the qualified opinion. An exegete who is master in Quran language, in the Quran, in the Sunnah, in the Aqidah, in Usul al-Fiqh, in Fiqh, is a master of these sciences. Only then he can go read the Quran and then extract rulings from this Quran. Type. What are the proofs from the Quran or from the what are the proofs that this type of tafsir is acceptable? ما هي أدلة جواز التفسير بالرأي؟ أورد الأئمة بعض الأدلة في القرآن كقوله تعالى في سورة محمد أفلا تدبرون القرآن أم على قلوب أقفالها. Don't they reflect on the Quran? Don't you have tadabbur in the Quran? So tadabbur of the Quran means to read it and try to understand and extract meanings from it. طبعاً, it is not really for you and me. We are not the type of people. Even our mashayikh in Azhar, they say that it is not even us who would read the Quran and understand, and just this ayah means this and this and this and that. And it is only for qualified scholars who really master all these sciences first. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Sad, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. Allah says that the Quran that we revealed to you for the people of intellect and the knowledgeable people to reflect on it and extract the meanings from the Quran. Also, from the Sunnah, a dalil that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم made dua to Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas. وقال اللهم فقهه في الدين وعلمه التأويل. Well, Allah grant Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas fiqh in deen, understanding of deen, and tafsir of the Quran, and ta'wil of the Quran. And we also know that lots of the Sahaba, they read the Quran, they did tafsir from the Quran by themselves. Right? So these are adilla of tafsir Burra. What are the most famous books of tafsir using this qualified opinion tafsir? And then, مثلا تفسير الجامع الأحكام القرآن للإمام القرطبي. الإمام القرطبي, who died year 671, has got a beautiful book which we'll talk about it in the next class, inshallah, called الجامع الأحكام القرآن. I have it in 25 volumes. So this book is also tafsir right. It is mainly a juristic tafsir. Lots of the fiqh in it, right? By Imam al-Qurtubi, and he's a Maliki. And we have a Hanafi tafsir equivalent book for Hanafi Imam, Imam al-Jassas. وعنده كذلك, his book is also called الجامع الأحكام القرآن. So he copied the Maliki Imam in the name. Like Hanafi is Imam al-Jassas. It's also a beautiful book, mashallah, Imam al-Jassas. And you find that Imam al-Qurtubi is, he will give you all the opinions of all madhahib. Imam al-Jassas, he will also do that, but he will try to make the Hanafi opinion as the chosen opinion. Type. We have as well Kitab Ruh al-Ma'ani fi Tafsir al-Qur'an al-Azim al-Sab' al-Mathani for Imam al-Alusi, who died year 1270. This is a very, very recent, it's only 200 years old tafsir by Imam al-Alusi. Short name for it is Ruh al-Ma'ani. One of the most beloved tafsir to me personally. It is يعني, a comprehensive encyclopedia in tafsir. It talks about the Qur'an. You find Qura'at, you find Ahkam, you find Tarbiyat, Arabic language. Lots of things in this book. And I have it in 30 volumes. تفسير روح المعاني في روح المعاني في تفسير القرآن السبع المثاني كذلك تفسيري أنوار التنزيل وحقائق التأويل للإمام البيضاوي والإمام النسفي الإمام البيضاوي طبعا الإمام الشافعي شهير وإمام النسفي إمام حنفي شهير so also أنوار التنزيل وحقائق التأويل for الإمام البيضاوي والشافعي died year 691 والإمام النسفي equivalent حنفي 1701 again every time a Shafi'i imam comes and do a tafsir or a book of fiqh you find that a Hanafi imam will go ahead and do and copy him and do the equivalent Hanafi based tafsir like for example Ashbah al-Nadair كتاب الأشباه والنظائر في القواعد الفقهية الإمام السيوطي وجدت أن الإمام ابن نجيم الحنفي كمان صنف كتابه أسماء الأشباه والنظائر كمان وأنوار التنزيل رح الإمام النسفي عمل أنوار التنزيل وهكذا الجصاص جامع أحكام القرآن من إيه زي جامع أحكام الإمام القرطبي right so these are the most famous books in the qualified opinion on these types of tafsir last slide and then we'll finish inshallah طيب as for the types of tafsir So the first two types are the methodologies of the tafsir, either narration-based or qualified opinion. But then when an imam do a tafsir book, then you find that usually this tafsir is focused on one perspective of the ayat. Like one tafsir will focus on the linguistics of the Qur'an. So you find that the imam talks a lot about the meaning of this word in Arabic and this balagha and the figures of speech and the metaphorical use of the language and the master use of the language, etc. فيغلب على هذا التفسير الطابع اللغوي. So we find that the flavor, the linguistic flavor, is actually very obvious. And you find it all the other things in tafsir in it, aspects of tafsir, but the linguistic aspect is the most obvious. Right? Another type is the juristic tafsir. And usually if the imam is like a faqih, is one of the scholars of fiqh, you find that his tafsir will be the juristic side of aspect is very, very obvious on the expense of all the other aspects. If he's an imam in language, then you find that like Imam al-Zamakhshari, مثلا تفسير الكشاف يغلب عليه الطبع اللغوي البحر المحيط لأبو حيان وعلم مفسر حتى قالوا أن كتابه البحر المحيط أقرب إلى يكون كتاب نحو وصرف منه إلى كتاب تفسير. إيش معنى أوجه الإعراب والبناء والبلاغة في القرآن؟ قالوا أشبه بكتاب نحو وكتاب منه إلى كتاب تفسير. الإمام الفخر الرازي مثلا مفاتيح الغيب مسمى بالتفسير الكبير قالوا فيه كل شيء إلا التفسير وهو 20 مجلد. تجد إمام تكلم عن العقائد وعلم الكلام والنفح والدفاع عن العقيدة الإسلامية وهدم العقائد الأخرى، فأصبح كتاب في علم العقيدة منه إلى كتاب إيش؟ تفسير. طيب. So we have this juristic tafsir, linguistic tafsir, inner dimension tafsir, which is the tafsir of the heart, the taskiya, and the ishara tafsir al-ishari in the Quran. ويتكلم عن علوم القلوب وعلم التربية وعلم السلوك وعلم القرب إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى. فتفسير يغلب عليه هذا الطابع. So the tafsir, it is, see, the most common aspect of it is the taskiya, purification of the heart, purification of the nafs. This is called the tafsir al-ishari. It's called what? Tafsir al-ishari. Example of it is tafsir al-qushayri, tafsir al-bahr al-madid, ibn Ajiba, Ahmed ibn Hussein ibn Ajiba, ila akhir. طيب. And there is scientific tafsir, and there is analytical. Of course, scientific tafsir is that the mufassir, the exegete, will talk a lot about the scientific miracles of the Quran. Analytical tafsir, which is like the jama. Tafsir al-tahlili, هي كتب يحاول المفسر فان يغطي جميع جوانب التفسير. These are books that the exegete will try to cover the linguistic aspects, juristic aspects, self-purification aspects, scientific aspects, قراءات. Everything, try to cover everything in the tafsir. Alright? So these are the types of tafsir, the methodologies of tafsir. Next slide. The end. Right? Next week, inshallah, we'll talk about the most common books of tafsir in detail. So we'll take like maybe 3 books or 4 books, and we'll talk about who is the imam, what this book is about, etc. And then inshallah we'll finish the introduction and we'll start the tafsir of Surah Al-Fatih, inshallah. SubhanAllah wa bihamdika, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayka, inshallah la ilaha illa anta.